the current, the present Christian community that we see in our country today, yes, it has its roots during the time that missionaries started, were allowed to come to India after the charter that British government passed in 1833. Before that, the missionaries were not allowed to come to this land as missionaries. They would come as chaplains and in other forms, but not as missionaries. And then starting from 1834, when American Presbyterians sent their first missionary, John C. Laurie, to Ludhiana, and then they progressed toward Lahore and the area around that. At that time, there was an agreement. It was called Carmody Agreement. And even today, we'll see a very clear map. ARP Church towards Sahiwal, and then Lahore and surroundings was AP Church, American Presbyterian Church. But AP Church had been divided into councils. And after partition in 1947, the only council of, I think, the eight councils that was that fell in Pakistan was Lahore Church Council. And in 1853, the Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church, the Reformed Church, there was a long chain. There are different denominations that are trying. Associate Presbyterian Church, Reformed Presbyterian Church, and then the United to form Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church. And there is a very beautiful tree you can draw from all these unions and divisions. And missionaries started coming, and then many unions took place in America and then here as well. The last one that took place was in Pakistan was in 1992, when Lahore Church Council and the United Presbyterian Church of Pakistan made a union to form Presbyterian Church of Pakistan, which is currently the Presbyterian Church of Pakistan. I feel very proud to be part of the very significant history that this particular denomination has created in this land. As you asked me my testimony, I think I am so thankful. I am so full of gratitude for my faith journey. It started in a very humble family, very sort of with hand-to-mouth means. At the Gujranwala Seminary, my father worked in the facilities there. We were six siblings. Thanks be to God for the vision that my parents had. They moved from village to city so that they can educate their children. And they, even though they were not very resourceful, it was very difficult for them to even meet the basic needs, but they were so committed, so dedicated to send their children to school. So always hats off and salutes to my parents for their vision. I think vision is something that doesn't have anything to do with degrees. And my parents had that vision. If they had not sent us to school at that time, I would be maybe in some shop serving as a, you know, maybe a cycle repairer or something else. But I look back, and there was a time in my life when I started, you know, when the world started making little sense to me. I felt very uncomfortable what I saw around. I think the Christian faith that we inherited, we were very punctual going to Sunday school and to church and learning all the Bible stories and learned about, you know, how we were Christians and what Christians would look like. And as a very young boy, when I started analyzing things, I felt a very huge gap between what we learned and what we saw. And a time came in my life when I was actually I had said, you know, goodbye to my faith, and I did not want to have anything to do with it. I look back and I give thanks to God for people who started praying for me, who were, who showed some concern and helped me not to go too far, brought me back to my faith. And I just started reading the Bible. And I think the highlight of my my Christian journey is reading the Bible. When I started reading the Bible, everything changed for me. Maybe there were some areas of my brain that would never have opened if I had not started reading the Bible. So even today, I'm in my pastoral ministry, and when I get to teach to seminary students or wherever I get an opportunity, I make sure that I share this secret with people, secret of success, secret of knowing the truth, and secret of finding meaning in life is read the Bible. Well, so that's in a nutshell my testimony.
Well, thank you very much. As I can recall, almost 20 years ago when I was in seminary, GTS 1999, I think you just came back after your BMin, I think with your doctorate, and you started teaching church history over there, and I was in a class. So that's fascinating. And anyway, we know that education is liberation, and especially in a Pakistani context, where Christian community being a 3% and living under the poverty line, and also have a certain kind of poverty and burdens over their shoulders. So church played a great role. And recently we have a new rector in Pakistan's and the Presbyterians historical chartered university, former Christian College University right now. And how much they are contributing. So besides that, there are certain other legacy which left by the Presbyterians in Pakistani context. So would you please tell us about what is the legacy of the history of particular Presbyterian Church in Pakistan?
Presbyterian Church in Pakistan has a very rich, I'm not going to make an arrogant statement, but a humble statement, but to make a meaning that very proud history of improving the world around us. When missions came to Pakistan, it was not just teaching people that, oh, you are sinful and you need to forget, ask for forgiveness and God will save you. Presbyterians did much more than that. Even today, the legacy that Presbyterian Church has created in this land, in health department, in education, it is recognized in the highest levels. Our government recognizes that, the community recognizes that, and that impact continues to make a difference. You mentioned the rector of Farman Christian University. Farman Christian University is one of the best universities in the country right now. And it's probably the most effective, I would say. Thankfully, we have people who God sent here who had great vision and love for the people of this country. Dr. James Tabby just retired. And last Sunday at Nolakha Church, we bid him farewell and we miss him. They are gone back to their country now. And the new person that God has sent is Dr. Jonathan Edelton. Very well equipped for the job. A man of very high caliber. And so this past Sunday, he was at Nolakha Church. We welcomed him to Pakistan, and he seems to be a very great person. I enjoyed meeting him, and hoping that what Dr. Peter Amakas did, and then Jim Tabby followed him, and he's just going to pick it up from there and take it even higher. So we have high hopes from him. And yes, through education, Presbyterian Church has served in the past mightily and continues to do that, not only Farman Christian University, but Presbyterian Education Board. We currently have 25 schools, functional schools that are doing very well, and almost all of them in areas where normally no person who has a business mind will ever even think of starting a school. So Presbyterian Education Board is investing in education, taking it to the far off areas, and with same dedication, with same mission focus. Even today, education is not commercial for us. It is a commitment and it's our mission.
Well, thank you very much. You have mentioned two quite critical areas which were established by the Presbyterians at the early stages, education and medical. And one critique, as a missiologist, I could see that one critique comes from this, from the scholar practical theologians, is about this. These two approaches are totally under the colonial rule, how they flourish. How do you see that in the Pakistani context, the reception of and the continuity of this mission, as well as what addition did you see that the local leadership has added into that mission model in Pakistani context?
Could you come again, please?
Yeah. So my question is, it's a kind of a critique on these two medical and educational models, which has been critiqued by the theologian, a practical theologian, missiologist, as a part of a colonial rule in that context. How do you see that critique and the continuity of that ministry in current situation in Pakistan? And that's the first part. Number two is, what added by the local leaders now? How they extended this one, or are they still keeping the same model, or is there any some kind of a new addition, new cultural creative model added in this context?
First of all, colonial, the idea of colonialism will get confused if we do not make a distinction here. British government, if we mean colonial by just being British, British government for the longest time when they were here, they blocked, they did not allow missions to come here. They did a lot of good things here as a government, but when missionaries came here with a totally different concept. And also I'm sure even you mentioned a while ago about the Portuguese and all those people who were working with among the high class. When missionaries came here, they tried the high class, but for many years they could not find any success. And then eventually Holy Spirit led them to focus on the low caste people. So they worked among the lower tribes, and God moved and Holy Spirit moved, and mass movements took place. People converted to Christianity. People embraced Christianity as a hope of their social change for them, and also their salvation. So I think that church spread education among those classes. So if it was just colonial aspect, then they would not have started rural schools. They would not have started anything even in Nolakha area, the Rangmahal school. I think the church changed that colonial the stigma from the church. When they starting paying attention to their people who were not very prominent. The people who responded to gospel, they say were the people who overheard gospel, but then they drew the attention of the church, And I think that we have come a long way. We still have a long way to go, but we have come a long way as Christian community in this part of this land. That we once we were nobodies, but now we have produced people who have been in the highest ranks of the society. They are spread throughout the world. They even in Pakistan now we can very proudly say that we are making a difference. Education, if church is getting recognition and respect for spreading education, I think this is a very high credit for the church. So I think that the, when church spread education and health, that had nothing to do with the colonial mindset. They reached to the masses, the common people. And it continues even today. I think that local people, when they were given opportunity, and it's been many decades now that local leadership took over. I don't need to go very far back. Presbyterian Education Board, the current present director of that board, she took over. It was the Presbyterian Education Board had been confined to one room because all the schools had been nationalized and there was nothing new that was starting. And then toward the end of 90s, when denationalization took place, until then, there had been 25 years of a failed education system that government was not able to maintain and eventually gave up and decided to return the schools back. Pakistani leadership took over, and now Presbyterian Education Board is a resurrected institution. It was given back to church as a dead body, but now it is a huge success story. It is one of the best stories of any level in this country. And local leadership, Pakistani leadership played a role there. Even our other institutions, if they have survived this far, they have survived because of the leadership that took over from missionaries, who left a long time ago. There are a lot of problems, a lot of weaknesses, many challenges, because the world is changing also, changing very fast. But I think that local leadership has made immense. We are blessed to have very gifted people. Even today, when I think of their names, I think with very high respect for them.
Well, thank you very much. And it's indeed a great legacy. And we know that education is the key of success in Pakistani context, especially. And Presbyterian Education Board and Presbyterian Mission through education and medical services are playing a great role. And not only that one, actually, if you see that in the early 1960s and 70s, there was a very famous model which was introduced by Donald McGovern from here, where I am right now, Fuller Theological Seminary. And that was church growth model. And interestingly, that was a model which was adopted from Indian context, which Dr. Abel is also referring to, a mass movement. And that mass movement has given not only to the north part of the India, but also to the south part of India, and also around there when they started homogenous group. And that model has been applied in the United States of America as a successful model for even today. These mega churches, they are a fruit and a product of this church growth model which Donald McGovern introduced, and that was also a gift of Indian subcontinent to the North American churches. And so we will continue, as Dr. Abel says, that before partition, 1947, when it was United, when it was India, British India, which we call, that was a different scenario. But after partition, we came under the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, and then gradually we saw that how the transition from a secular, moderate Pakistan to we entered into highly extremist Pakistan when we talk about religious perspective. So Dr. Abel, what are the current internal challenges which church is facing, and externally both?
I think that there was never a period when church did not have challenges, starting from early church. The church survives in the midst of all kinds of challenges. The church in Pakistan has a very unique situation. We are a very small minority, maybe around 1 to 2%. I don't think, sometimes we like to say it, maybe around 3%, but I'm not sure about that anymore, but at least 2%. And our government records show even smaller than a percent, 1%, I think. We live in a Muslim majority population area setting, and we also face, I think, a very unique kind of extremism. It's not present in many, you know, everywhere in the way it is present here. So I think that this is one of the biggest challenges. The country of Pakistan, when we talk about, you know, the persecuted countries, probably falls on the 7th or 8th in the world. It is not easy to live as a Christian. It is a challenge. When I was growing up as as a young Christian, I remember during my college years, there were days when we were tempted to even hide our identity as Christians, because in the college of 6,000 or 7,000, if there are only 10-20 scattered here and there, hardly even hard to find each other, in that setting, it is difficult to survive that kind of environment. So the church in Pakistan has, I think its challenges can be categorized, the internal and external. Among external, yes, very big pressure from the extremism. We have unfortunately had a few tragic incidents that changed our life in a huge way. For example, the blasphemy law and the history that was created because of Shantinagar and Korea and Gojra, even Joseph Clooney in Lahore, it changed a lot for the community in Pakistan. How confidently we live, how bold and confident our youth are. I think similarly, being a minority, it is difficult to get the same opportunities as a majority community. It is difficult to survive as Christian if you are extraordinarily gifted, then you are the last of the person to be considered for any position. So I know too many gifted people who just were convinced that they have to go somewhere else to survive, to try their fortune somewhere else. I think despite the fact that we have created a legacy in education, health, in the military, in civil areas, in multiple ways, still there is a lot of frustration, a lot of deprivation, not enough recognition, I think. What's the place we are, what kind of percentage we are allocated in the country's budget, national budget. It's very embarrassing to mention that amount. Even our representatives in the national assemblies, provincial assemblies, we don't have the right to choose our candidates. They are selected by the respective parties. So there is a lot of discussion going on, where is our voice that we deserve, the place that we deserve. We are not immigrants to this land. We are natives. Pakistani Christians are the ones who did not travel from outside. We were the local people. We were here, and then other people migrated to this land and started living among us, around us, and they started taking over from us. I think that this is not easy struggle. It has a lot of, it makes a lot of difference. It changes things, you know. Internally, as a community, because we came from a very low background, low classes, trying to survive, trying to, you know, remove the stigma on our communities. Even today, you know, the derogatory titles and terms are used for Christians. It has penetrated into the society more than we would like to think, or we think that we know. It's much deeper there. It's not going to go away very easily. Even today, there are people who would not want to eat in the same utensils that a Christian uses. I think that we maybe do not like to talk much about it, but that is very much there. Fortunately, some of us who live in rural areas and with the more educated community, maybe they don't get to experience that much. But overall, it is a very, very bitter fact that even today, this stigma is there. Economically, Christians are even today on the lower side. Majority of Christians in Pakistan are living under the poverty line. I know, for example, there are about 400 to 500,000 Presbyterians in this country. Almost 80% of the of those, they live in the rural areas. And most of them, they live under poverty line. Even today, even though Christians have created, been able to create a legacy in education, too many Christians even today are not able to get that benefit from that education. I think the pace of growth development is not as fast as we would like it to be. The gap is even getting bigger. The economic gap, the social gap. These are challenges. And as a church leader, I think we have come a long way, but still there's a long way to go.
Well, thank you very much for these sharing these internal and external challenges. And as we have seen, that there's a certain global crisis among the faith tradition around the world, not only with the Presbyterians, even in North America. Our previous president, I hope we have a new president now, and the previous president even switched his Presbyterian denomination to a congregational denomination. So we have seen an unprecedented decline and the crumbling of the Presbyterian church, not only in the North America, but as well as in the Pakistani Presbyterian church as well as. So what do you think, what are the factors which made it, which put us in a crisis, whether it's a leadership crisis, whether it's an educational crisis, whether it's a behavior or a Christian character crisis? How you define it as a leader of the church, how you see the fragmentation of the church, the division in the church, and then the some kind of activities which are tainting the image of the church in our context? How can we overcome that?
Well, I think one of our huge problems is that in our community, there is a very serious lack of recognizing leadership. You know, I sometimes tell people that if you criticize somebody, you have a right to criticize them if you first own them as your leaders. In our community, unfortunately, and I don't want to mention it as a blame on anybody, but I think it's something that we have inherited and gradually we are coming out of it, is that we have a frustration or a desire in us to be recognized, to be valued. And when you come from low class backgrounds, where you were not anybody, you know, you were not treated as somebody, and then you come out and then you want to suddenly want to be known and you want to be respected, and some people see it, see the result to that in some sort of title, entitlement, you know, And then we once we get a title, then we think that I have reached there. But I think that gradually our society, our community is coming to terms with the fact that the title is not recognition. Title is not everything. Leadership is not something that comes with the a badge, but leadership is something that you show in your character. So it's a test of character. It's how you depict that character in you that will prove that yes, you are leading something.
Thank you. I think that's resonated with the culture, because we belong to that culture, which is shame and honor culture. And as Dr. Abel has just mentioned, that mostly people and the leadership which arises from nowhere without any identity. And that's the culture we also belong to, and we came from that culture where we have a caste system, and we are not belong to that caste system. Even some people, they adopt few castes to make identity, to show some kind of superiority from the lower caste and then the class system. So caste and class, and that's all becoming all together. And then they are fighting about the seats and the power and the privileges which we are enjoying, and that's eclipsing the ecclesial identity. Well, what is the role, Dr. Abel, you see? Because as a church, as a part of the Presbyterian Church, and as a product, I would call myself as a part of the product of the Presbyterian Church, we all have been from the same seminary, from the same curricula, from the same teacher, and the same same atmosphere. How do you see that? What role does seminary education can play when we produce leaders and the next generation of pastors in Pastor? And you are currently serving as a chairperson of the executive board of the seminary, also GTS Seminary. So how do you see the role of the seminary and the theological education for changing this perspective and having a serving heart rather than having a power play and the privileges?
Well, I am so glad you mentioned seminary. Seminary is one institution that you and I, we both love very much, very dearly. You are one of the people because you also got training there. You can tell what I mean by that. But for myself, even I was born on that campus. So, the place where you're born, that becomes very intrinsic part of you. So wherever I go in the world, the seminary, is not ever separated from me. I always think a lot about seminary and a lot that I want to do for the seminary. Thankfully, by the grace of God, seminary has survived in life. I was anybody or you, but because God wanted you to survive. And now we are at a stage when we can be tools, for Holy Spirit to take it forward. Nobody is indispensable, but I think that seminary is the best gift given to the church in Pakistan. Gujranwala Seminary has produced at least 80% of the leadership that we have seen in Pakistan across denominations, not just one denomination. And I think that if there was no seminary, there would not be a church in Pakistan. They have produced leaders, they have produced very genuine people. You cannot judge the fruit of the seminary with just one or two pieces. But if you look at it overall, Gujranwala Seminary has played a very instrumental, very pivotal role in the building of the church in Pakistan. Even today, it continues that. And if we are serious enough about it, you and I both know that even for the future of the church, seminary's role is extremely important. It is inevitable for the church. And I hope and I pray that seminary survives and survives well. It comes back on its feet and, is able to match with the international standards and, produce very quality leadership, which I believe that seminary has the potential to do that. And hopefully, we will be able to contribute and make our own contribution to build this great institution. I have nothing but admiration for it.
But undoubtedly, seminary has played a great role as a blood in the vein of the church and the Presbyterian Church in Pakistan. It's pumping and creating new lives. And I would like to proclaim here also that one and testimony that the Tehleem School of Church Music and Worship is also a byproduct and a result of the seminary education. Our previous moderator, Emeritus Dr. Arthur James Late, and also his vision that established this School of Church Music and Worship, which was handed over to me by the under the auspices of the Presbyterian Executive Board in 2004. And this is the continuity of that relationship and the fruit of the ministry. Dr. Abel, so let's conclude our conversation this evening. So what do you want to convey a message to our global partners and also to the future leaders in Pakistan, to the coming leaders? So first address to the global partners, and then we come to the local partners.
Eric, I was sharing with one of my colleagues the other day that I've always almost been 30 years that I was ordained. I was ordained in 93. So in a couple more years, it will be 30 years. I've served as a pastor, as a church leader, as a servant of God, in different capacities. There are a lot of times we talk about frustrations and problems, but overall, I tell you, my brother, I think there are so many blessings that I can list here. I think we will not have enough time to list those, but we have to. I was sharing in the Sunday service from the story of the lepers. Just one came back. There is so much for us to be thankful and celebrate. We lose our own blessing when we focus only on the bad stuff. I have seen, you have seen recently that so much negative stuff is said for the institutions of the church or the church, and people very loosely talk about the church and its business. But I don't think that they have a clear picture and view of the blessings that God has given us. The church in Pakistan is a very blessed church in a lot of ways. The people of the church in Pakistan, I say they are very strange people. The more threat there is, the more they go to church. When you tell them to don't go to church today because there is a threat of terrorism, more people go to church that day. It's that kind of faith that we see among people here. So I want to tell to all my international friends that the church in Pakistan is a very faithful, very uniquely blessed church, blessed in a lot of ways. And I've also experienced those who come in touch with this church be blessed. Yes, there are problems. Yes, there are issues. But, what do we have Reformed theology for to teach us? That, shortcomings is, that's the theology we have. We can't avoid that, but we continue to be sanctified and grow in the Lord. There is a lot of promise here. The people of the church in Pakistan deserve a lot of respect. I also beseech the prayers of our international community as we pray for you. It's a challenge to live as Christian, but also a huge blessing, a huge gift our faith that we have been given in our Lord and Jesus, Savior Jesus.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Abel, for talking with us this morning and sharing the testimony and the legacy of the Presbyterian Church, and especially to our global partners. You know very well that Pakistan is a promise, and as we have shared earlier, although there are, despite the fact that we are having a lot of pressure, a lot of challenges, but beside that, church is faithful to its worship and a witness in that Islamic context. And we know that without our global partnership in God's mission and our participation, not only partnership with the partner, but also participation in God's mission in Pakistan. And Pakistan is a gateway to the Southeast Asia. We all know that. And Presbyterian Church, for more than a century, proved that this church has the potential to communicate gospel in a creative and cultural way. And we are, as a part of the church, as a serving and a humble servant, we present ourselves with all our weaknesses, that although we are not perfect, but we are, as Dr. Abel has said, as a reformed theology, we are reformed, but we are always keeping reformed. So we are still reforming, and hopefully we will have this rise and as the Presbyterian Education Board resurrected, we are praying that Gujranwala Seminary will resurrect and come back to its glory. We will see the church once again intact and strengthened for the strong witness in Pakistani context. Now, recently,
just want to take one second just to add to what you're saying. Don't mean to interrupt, but Gujranwala Seminary has a lot of solid plans for future building, especially. You and I have talked about that new building, a new block where we want to build modern classes and also add a music department there. We just started the conversation, and hopefully, you know, we will talk more and reach, you know, its practical existence there. I think there is a lot of promising happening there. God bless you for your best wishes for seminary also.
Sure, and so we are breaking this news now with the permission of Dr. Abel.
For prayers,
with prayers and lots of support. We need it's not a lone wolf business. It is a community, and we need all your prayers and blessings. So thank you very much for watching, and please keep praying on for the Presbyterian Church in Pakistan, for the leadership, for the ministry and the witness, and especially for the Gujranwala Seminary. Well, when God is going to do a great work in that country, and you will be part of that great movement, and you will be proud of that. May God bless you all, Dr. Majid Abel, for your time and your leadership. We praise God for you and your family, and your untiring efforts for the Presbyterian Church in Pakistan. And we are looking forward for more partnership and more work. God bless you.